Okay, guys, welcome back from the lunch. And those of you who have still not finished, do hurry up if you don't want to miss Bharat Beedu from Nutanix. Bharat, so you like riding motorcycle, as yes. I heard. So yes. Are you planning on taking a joyride down Serbia, up Serbia, left and right?
It's absolutely on my bucket list. I want to spend a month of riding in Europe, explore all the different places.
What was your last ride?
The last big ride that I did was a trip to Mexico.
From where?
From California. Oh, nice. So it was one of these December breaks. We had 10 days off. What do you do? Just ride on a motorcycle. Did like 3,500 miles over 10 days. Went through a lot of small villages. Stayed over. It was beautiful. I mean, it was beautiful. The people are so warm.
Just don't plan on riding bike in December here in Serbia.
Absolutely not.
Maybe, you know, late June would be the best for you.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. So soon I will give the floor to you. Just, yeah, the room is filling up slowly.
Sure.
Guys, the Q&A session will be taken after this talk over to Nutanix and Frame booth. So if you need to ask Bharat anything, if your mind is tingling with questions, you can find him over there immediately after this session. So the floor is yours now. Good luck. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. All right. Welcome all. My name is Bharat Beedu. I work at Nutanix. And in this talk, I'd like to share some of the insights, experiences, building a distributed file system. We built the distributed file system leveraging a lot of the open source components that are available at that point of time, which was Cassandra, Zookeeper, MapReduce concepts. So we'd like to take you through the journey. And we'll cover, before we get into the details of the file system, I would like to also answer the why behind it, right? Like, why did we build a distributed file system? So I'll cover some of the concepts of hyperconvergence. Then we'll dive deep into the file system itself, and also like how we use open source beyond file systems to build interesting services and products. Right. So just to set the context, this is a product that powers data centers, the enterprise data centers. So just to set the context for this. All right. So let's cover the genesis of hyperconvergence. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the term hyperconvergence. We have a few Nutanix related employees. Great. So I'll answer why hyperconvergence, like what does it really mean, right? So in a traditional data center, we had a typical three-tier architecture. You know, just like you have the web apps, there are three tiers. You have the compute provided by the blade servers. There's no storage there, just compute. Running on top of it are virtual machines. And these are the virtual machines that power the enterprise apps. Your databases, mail servers, what it may be, right? And you can see that the storage for it traditionally has been provided by SANs, right, which are like storage boxes. And gluing them all together was a network. And this was not generic any network. It was like, you had special storage networks created by the likes of Brocade. So you had storage switches that connected the compute and the storage. Now, you can see that with this, with the VMs can move pretty easily, right? The computes can migrate from node to node. VMware has solved a problem with vMotion and other technologies. But storage becomes extremely hard to move, right? And along the way, what happens is you end up with silos, right? So you have one storage, you're running out of storage, you buy another sandbox, you put a different set of applications on top. And before you know, it's all very tightly coupled. Moving data from one box to another box is expensive, right? And also, the network starts becoming a bottleneck at some point. You have other issues. You have the noisy neighbor issues, like you have a VM that's hitting the storage hard. All other VMs that use that particular storage box suffers performance-wise. In addition, you have all the manageability headache. You have different vendors. You have different upgrade cycles, different lifecycle management. Painful, right? And another big thing that happens with this kind of architecture is you have a very suboptimal scaling story, right? So you have your size right, and tomorrow you have five employees joining. You want to enable five VMs for them. You don't have storage, so you end up buying another box. And once you end up buying another box, that has enough storage for 2 years, but for almost a year and a half, you're not using it at capacity. You're just paying for stuff that you're not using, right? So now let's see, like, how do web companies do it, right? So this is how web companies have built their data centers. It's based on fundamental few assumptions, right? So which is x86 hardware, unbranded, nothing special about the hardware, just generic CPU, memory, storage. And it's based on the premise, the assumption is that these things will fail. At the scale that you're talking about, there's always a disk blowing up, network card that doesn't work. The assumption that things are going to fail is baked in. And not just that, all the intelligence is now moved into software. It's not the hardware that's special that handles failures. It's the software that handles failures. That's the only way it's cheap enough and scalable enough, right? And what are the design goals that drive this, right, of web scale, web generation data centers? So you have no single point of failure. It's distributed purely, fully. And it's linear and predictable performance. As you have the number of users grow, you need to have linear and predictable performance. And it's an always-on system. There is no, like, oh, I'll do an upgrade, I'm going to have time, right? You can't have your Facebook go down, and people, there's going to be a rebellion. And what is really, in essence, bringing is the compute and data together, right? Try to bring it together so it works at scale. So this is really, like, the genesis of, like, you know, hyperconvergence. So let's go back now to the three-tier architecture that we have, and let's superimpose hyperconvergence on it. So traditionally, you have this x86, multiple nodes. They all talk to a couple of controllers, right, in the storage box. In the storage box, they added flash to make it faster, but it's still a couple of controllers. Now, what if we added storage to each node, basically bring storage to where the compute is, right? We add storage to each node. We have multiple controllers. So it's not just one or two controllers. As many nodes there are, we have as many controllers, right? So, and then you build a distributed file system that provides one unified storage fabric, right? So with this system, what you really have is one unified storage, which each node contributing storage resources, as well as a controller VM, a controller on each of these nodes. So you have extreme scalability and performance. And this is actually the web scale, right? So it's linear scale out to large aggregate performance. You're linearly scaling out. And this is a driving philosophy of hyperconverged system with web scale, right? Which is resource needed in any particular component on any particular node is proportional to the resources at the node and not to the size of the cluster. So you don't have uneven one node having a lot of storage, a lot of compute, none of it. It's all democratic, right? Everybody is equal. So this is how we built hyperconvergence. Did the technology work? Yes, it did. So we started off with the web scale concepts, build a file system. And with that file system, we ended up having high reliability, high performance, serviceability. That's a big part, right? So on this distributed file system, you can support rolling upgrades. So there's zero downtime. You can have each node upgrade. And as the node gets upgraded, the IOs that are coming to that particular controller is shared across the cluster. Right? So you end up with the web scale, just like the Facebooks and the Google, you end up having the ability to have rolling upgrades. And then once we did that, like the file system, we added all the features that a file system needs to have, compression, encryption, snapshots. And we made this distributed file system run on any kind of hypervisor, ESX, vSphere, VMware ESX, Hyper-V, KVM. And we also made it run on any kind of hardware, Dell, IBM, Lenovo, HP, right? And with this, what we really did was enable our customers, our enterprises, to run any app in their VM, right? So they have Oracle Rack running on us. There you can have SAP HANA running on this file system. So it did really work technology-wise, and it did work for the business. It's great technology, it did work for the business. Yes, it did work. So the hyperconvergence market is something that we defined, ended up going from zero to $1 billion in revenue in 7 years now, less than 7 years. And the company, the market cap of $9 billion. So, and Gartner, you know, they recognize us as the leaders with this architecture that we have. So that's enough of the why. Why did we build a distributed file system, right? Which is at the heart of hyperconvergence. Now, I'd like to go a little bit deeper into how we build a distributed system, right? Like the Nutanix distributed file system. How did we leverage open source components? So what is NDFS, really, right? What's the file system? So if you really look at it, this is a single node that has the hypervisor. These are the raw disks that provide storage. You have the CVM. That's a controller VM where all of our microservices run, the file system microservices run in user land, user space, inside the CVM. The I/O that comes in gets routed to our to this controller VM that manages the data that lies on the storage. But at the same time, there's another copy of data that's put around the cluster so that you have redundancy, right? If this node goes down, the disk goes down, there's always data that's around. Right. Now let's dive a little bit deeper into a single node. Right. In a single node, we have the CVM, we have the file system, two parts to it. One is the interface to it. So you have iSCSI, NFS, SMB, any kind of interface that you can use to talk to the file system. And it's built on a different, supports different hypervisors. And the whole advantage of doing this all in software is we can enable features very easily. Right, like compression, encryption. Every software update, you can push a new feature in. There's no hardware dependency on this. There's no hardware encryption chip that's required for this to work. Right, it's all in software. So, so what does it take to build a distributed file system? Right, so a few fundamental pieces that we need. We need a distributed global metadata service. So for this, we use Cassandra, like you know, giant number one. That was like a beast of a software. And then we need a global health cluster health monitoring. And we use Zookeeper for that. And also, at the size that we're talking about, we need a scalable out-of-band data management service. And that we built based on MapReduce concepts. So just to give a sense of what large data is, each node can have between 20 and 200 terabytes of data. And we're talking about a cluster that goes from 3 nodes to around 123 nodes, 124 nodes. So you're talking about large scale, large amount of data that stays on these clusters. So we did this with open source, right? And why did we pick open source? Hyperconvergence, as a market, we weren't sure about it. We needed proof of concept. We needed an MVP. With these open source components, we were able to build it in 2.5 years, all right? And like everybody knows, like the software half-life is shrinking. You start building from scratch. By the time your product is ready, the market has moved on. So we built this in 2.5 years. We were able to get to the market first. And then we saw that there's a product market fit, that yes, people loved it. So then we can build on it and invest more into it. Right? So let's go a little bit deeper into now Cassandra. Why did we pick Cassandra, giant one? So metadata service, right? So a metadata service for a distributed file system. What are the key things that we need? We need scale out, strict consistency and partition tolerance. Assume everything fails. Assume there's failure all the time in a cluster. No single point of failure, right? We cannot have one thing take the whole service down. And really, we cannot do transactions at the scale that we are talking about. At 100 plus nodes, you can't do transaction. You can't support transaction semantics. So we picked Cassandra, which was the leading open source NoSQL database at that point. It's built around sharding its data across all the nodes that form the Cassandra ring. So that way, every node in the cluster participates in storing metadata. And it's also a user space service, right? So failure is easily tolerated. You restart Cassandra on that particular node. But because the high availability is guaranteed, we're still getting requests being serviced from somewhere else. But we just didn't use Cassandra as is. We had to do a bunch of optimizations, customizations, and extensions. So one of the big things that we did was we added consistency, right? So a file system has to be consistent. So what we did was we used Paxos to update the objects. And the way we did it is like each object has its own state machine, the replicated state machine. That's how Cassandra works. But we built Paxos per object. And each of these nodes can do billions of objects, right? And object, from our perspective, is the piece of metadata that describes where the data is in the cluster. Right? So this is, makes it extremely scalable. We also added did a bunch of caching improvements for lowering the latency. So when I talk about latency, the kind of requirements that we have is an I/O needs to be serviced in a under a couple of milliseconds. For example, SAP HANA that runs on this file system needs to service I/Os under a millisecond. So those are the kind of requirements that that we have. We also cluster management out of Cassandra, the cluster management of the Cassandra cluster out of Cassandra, just to keep the amount of things that it does less. Plus, we have Zookeeper that I'll talk about next that we use. So we pull the function out into Zookeeper. And instead of having two gossip protocols running in two different places, just have it in one place. Right? We did a bunch of system-level improvements for Cassandra. For example, SS tables, the compaction of SS tables, that's where the actual data lies. We said we made it much more smarter. We used HyperLogLog to analyze what are the hot areas, what are the hot data sets, and do a little bit smarter SS table compactions. We also added fast addition and removal of nodes into the Cassandra ring. In a distributed system, you always have nodes that have to be pulled out of service. You also need to have nodes that come into the cluster as expansion happens. And you need to be able to read, balance, and distribute the metadata that you have across the node. Or if you're taking a node out of service, you need to evacuate all the metadata out of it. Right? So we did a bunch of changes there to do this fast copy of these SS tables across the cluster so that it can evacuate fast. Right? So these are all the customizations we did. We have a team of around 15 engineers who work on this for the last 5-6 years now. So let me go to the second giant, Zookeeper. Right? So in a distributed system, what are the key things that we need? Right? We need leader election. Everything is master-slave model. Master dies, election happens, somebody else becomes a master and we among the slaves, and life continues on. Right? Business continues on as usual. We also needed a distributed lock manager, a global configuration manager that all nodes in a cluster can see. We needed config change notification. Config change happens often, but everybody in the cluster needs to be aware of it. Like node goes out, everybody needs to be aware of it. And of course, cluster health. So these were all the, a component that needs all of this. And Zookeeper was the right fit. Perfect fit, mature open source project at that point. It has a distributed lock manager. We don't use it as a very fine-grained lock. We use it as a lock that we lock unlock at a frequency of not more than 1 minute, right? So it's low frequency usage of the distributed lock manager. We also get all the change notifications. And then we ended up doing a bunch of customizations on top, right? So we added automatic migration of Zookeeper nodes in case of node failures. So the Zookeeper picks 3 nodes for Quorum. We can migrate the Zookeeper node from one node to another node. We also did Quorum expansion beyond 3 nodes, because as a distributed file system, we wanted to support multiple fault tolerance of more than one. If 2 nodes go down, the file system still needs to work. Right? So we went from 3 to 5 Zookeeper nodes. We added protection against network data corruption. We also did rack awareness. That's because when you have 120 hundreds of nodes, you put it in racks. And we wanted the Zookeeper nodes to be spread across the racks so that if a rack fails, we still have continuation, right? The Zookeeper service doesn't go down. And of course, we pulled the cluster, Cassandra cluster management into Zookeeper. So these are all the customizations that we did and extensions that we did over time. And the third gen that I want to talk about is the MapReduce framework, right? What kind of requirement does a distributed system have, distributed file system have? So we have to do out-of-band data management. When an I/O comes in, you can't afford to do data management in line. That's too slow. We only have a millisecond to do everything we want. So we need an out-of-band data management service that scales out. You're talking about each node having between 20 and 100 terabytes of data. You can't have just one node do it all. You need the entire cluster to work together. Right, to do the data transformation. And basically, parallel task execution. Right? So you can see as the number of nodes increases in the cluster, the amount of work that each node does reduces. And when the amount of work reduces for data management, there's more CPUs that's available for servicing the user I/O, for the user VM that runs on the node, life is good. Right? Life just gets better. So So we developed an in-house MapReduce framework inspired Hadoop, HDFS. It's a generic framework that can used to distribute tasks. We made it very generic, and definition of tasks can be built in across all the nodes in the cluster. And what kind of tasks does this framework do, right? It does a bunch of different things. It moves data between different storage tiers, right? So we have SSD on each node. We have hard drive in each node. The data is hot. It moves into SSD tier for fast access, low latency. When the data gets cold, we move it back into HDD, right? So there's data movement between these different layers. It checks for consistency of data and metadata. So there's bit rot that happens. This system periodically scans through all the data that is in the cluster, trying to spot those data corruption that might have occurred. It ensures there's enough replicas in the cluster, right? So each data is written twice in the cluster. If fault tolerance is 1, if fault tolerance is 2, it's written 5 times. But we need to make sure that if a disk goes down or a node goes down, the data that was there, there's a copy of it made elsewhere in the cluster, right? So this MapReduce framework takes care of that. And of course, when the node is added or removed, you're talking about removal of node, 20 to 100 terabytes of data needs to be pulled out. This framework helps you do that, right? So it pulls out data from one place and starts writing parallelly across the cluster and number of nodes. So it makes it really fast to evacuate data. And when the node is added again, load balance the data, move it from other nodes into this node. There's also garbage collection that happens of orphaned data, things that you have deleted. There's encryption, lazy encryption, dedupe, compression, all of these like offline activities. That's again done by this MapReduce framework. So with this, what we really built was three important concepts, and we brought the web service kind of design, the design that drives Google's file system. We kind of brought that in to enterprises, right, and built a highly tolerant, highly available, performant scale-out system. But this is not just where we stopped. I mean, open source has been still, we've been using, leveraging open source in other parts beyond file system. So we introduced our own hypervisor. It's called Acropolis Hypervisor. This is based on KVM, QMU, and libvirt and open vSwitch, right? So we did a bunch of customizations, improvements, giving back to the community, like try to increase the live migration performance. We made some changes in the data path so that you can do extremely low latency data transfers from the user VM into our system and back. We also reused a lot of these web scale constructs that we build in the file system layer in the control plane. So we build a scalable scale out management layer with the database that's powered partly by Cassandra, on Cassandra. So with this, the goal is to be able to manage thousands of VMs that run on this file system. You can manage the metadata of the file system, the config, the policies, the network policies, all the different things, right? And also going ahead, we are also building a multi-service a platform on Kubernetes, based on Kubernetes. This is where we want to run all of the Nutanix microservices. And also open this up, we have customers who run containers with using the distributed file system as a back storage backend. So we can see we are leveraging all of this. So this is how we have built it, and we continue to pick stuff from open source, improve upon it, give back to the community. Give talks, write papers, share what we learned. But with this, we are basically increasing the velocity with which we can deliver products. And looking at the way, if you look at it in the industry these days, that's what every company is doing. Ubers, they use Google Maps, Kafka, Cassandra. So use existing tools to build massive services on top. Building from scratch takes much, much longer. And in the current scheme of things, you'll probably be dead before you get started. So that's all I had. Thank you, folks. I'll be at the booth. Feel free to drop by We can talk more Cassandra, Zookeeper, file system, replication. We also have built up our own public cloud. We can talk about the architecture of that. I'm an engineer, so we can talk more details. Just giving a flavor of how we can build a distributed file system with open source. Thank you.